you want to hear those broadcasts. There was a man here in the front who had a question first.
Yeah, but there's, I mean, this conversation has been structured as a debate, but I mean, I don't think at the end it's going to be a winner or a loser. In reportage, there's a word that's always interested me, and that's insurgent. And I guess I'm thinking that if there were Russian battalions in the interlake or Chinese helicopters around the country and I took up arms, then I guess I would be defined as an insurgent. And so I wonder what it is that allows this term to be applied so easily to people who take up arms against invading foreign powers with huge military apparatus. Professor Heller has suggested that NATO's presence or the American presence in Afghanistan is a flanking operation vis-a-vis China and Russia. But I'd like to come away from this conversation with you, Professor Ferguson, with as clear as possible a statement about what the Americans are doing in Afghanistan. From where you sit, your perspective, your take on what are the Americans doing in Afghanistan? I mean, I know why Canada, I think I know why Canada, to the great glory of Stephen Harper and Andrew, but no, the Americans, what are the Americans doing in Afghanistan?
Just a quick comment on you first. I think it's fascinating why we call people who take up arms nowadays insurgents. I don't know the roots of the concept of insurgent and insurgency. It dates back, I think, to the 1950s and 60s. We used to call them guerrillas and rebels back in the older days. And it's interesting how language changes, why it changes, cover different things. Anyway, especially why is the United States in Afghanistan? First of all, I think it's important to remember that after the American funding and support to the Mujahideen to deal with the Soviet Union as part of the Cold War rivalry and struggle between East and West, that the United States washed its hands entirely of Afghanistan. It pulled out, it ignored it. When Al-Qaeda emerged, as the ebb and flow of the Civil War in Afghanistan took place, the United States could have cared less. Canada, we all ignored it. Until, of course, it came back to the door of the United States. I don't see any great, this idea of the great geostrategic importance of Afghanistan that dates back centuries and centuries, not millennia, to Afghanistan being the crossroads and the spice roads, spice routes between China and Russia, and the great game of the 19th century. I don't find any of that convincing at all. There's very little about evidence to support that in fact is any driver with this, because if you're trying to manage the issue of Russia, if this is a great power issue about Russia and about China and about India, Afghanistan is really marginal in all this. The problem with Afghanistan economically and politically, in many ways why Afghanistan ends up the way it is, today, and what's happened to it, is because no one's really interested in it because it's of very little value. The United States went into Afghanistan. We happen to see no evidence from what I've seen empirically, from any of the studies done, from any documents released in the United States, that there was any thinking or planning whatsoever to strike at Afghanistan prior to 9/11. After 9/11, someone, I think it's safe to say, someone had to pay for it. And Afghanistan was seen as responsible for, because they gave sanctuary to Al-Qaeda and then refused, as required under the UN mandate, to turn over the Al-Qaeda leadership to the international community. The result was, in effect, that the Taliban government committed an act of war on the United States, and the United States went to war to deal with Afghanistan. But whatever you think of the United States, the type of nation is, I would suggest to you that the United States went to Afghanistan, which demonstrates to me why the United States is not an imperial power. It's a superpower with global interests and global responsibilities. But it's not an imperial power because most imperial powers would have gone in, dealt with it, and then probably left because of its lack of strategic importance. The United States does carry, for good or ill, how badly they execute it, does carry a crusading mentality about exporting democracy and human rights and capitalist economy, if you like. And it just couldn't, when it went in there, it had to then do something. The international community had to do something. And there was a degree of responsibility, I think, that bore in some American decision-makers' minds about what the United States' failure to have done something in the 1990s. Hence, the United States and the Europeans at all, by our own sets of embedded social values and beliefs of what right and wrong is, ended up now trapped into the difficult problem of nation-building. And nation-building is a really, one thing we know empirically, nation-building is a really difficult, hard, long process which democracies aren't very good at. And we all know the difficulties of the problems of Afghanistan, which are partially a function of NATO and the Americans being there, that are partially a function of domestic internal forces, of ethnic forces, of Pakistan's involvement, of Iran, of India, all sorts of forces who are at play. But if you ask me why the United States went, they went because they felt that they had been attacked, and that someone needed to pay for this, and that they were not going to allow a hostile government, which they saw as a hostile government who had committed an act of war, not pay a price for it. And that price would be the end of the Taliban government. And then once that was finished, with lack of planning, as we saw in Iraq, by the way, NATO's not in Iraq, except for some training, so NATO, and the NATO lines split over Iraq, remember that. Most of the NATO lines in running knew with Iraq, it didn't go. And then they got into this, to go back to Afghanistan, and then they got into this difficult question of, well, what do we do? Now that we've done this, now what do we do? Well, we've seen the efforts. The billions of dollars pumped in, and all the problems associated with, and the realization, this is a long-term mission. Yes, it's going to come home. Because at the end of the day, it's not encircling China or Russia in Afghanistan. I mean, the geostrategic map, technology today, and strategic thinking today, basically says Afghanistan is irrelevant to this. It's not irrelevant to India and Pakistan, but they're two different actors.
Now, I just want to let you know, we have about 5 minutes left of the kind of question and answer segment, and Professor Heller, and then we'll, sorry, there was someone there, and then you.
Okay. In terms of this response to this, it was interesting, the statement, somebody has to pay as the reason. Somebody has to pay, and then there will be nation building. Following the payment, that is to say, the attack and the killing, there will be nation building. This is what was said here. These are the kind of the phrases that are used to justify what the Americans and their buddies are doing in Afghanistan. They're basically, they've killed a lot of people. And as for the nation building, let me tell you, this concept of nation building, well, you know, it has an etymology, it has a trajectory. You know, they used to call it the white man's burden or the civilizing mission back in the 19th century. It's rubbish rhetoric. This is what it is. Good governance, nation building.
Democracy.
Yeah, it's this rhetoric. That's what I've been complaining about all afternoon here. We get these words, these phrases that cover murder, a process of murder, and not only murder, but a cycle of murder, because the Americans in there, and the Canadians, in terms of what they're doing, they are creating the resistance. They have developed a self-perpetuating cycle of violence that is deeper and deeper and deeper in that society, become pathological. And they have an interest in continuing this. I'm saying that the people who are carrying on, justifying this, well, they are in the business of war making. That's what I've been trying to say. Institutionally, this is their business, killing people. Or preparing to kill people.